So, I bet your parents taught you well and told you don't listen to strangers, so I will introduce myself. I'm Omer Yair, I manage the endpoint team at Javelin Networks. We are a small startup that decided to protect your endpoint on the enterprise from, to protect your Active Directory from the endpoint. And Symantec believed in us and acquired us a few, like 9 months ago. Even though I'm still not sure how I'm supposed to pronounce the new title. I'm also a photographer, and you can follow me on Twitter. So, I want to start with the gist of this talk. It's a quote by Gilles Deleuze, a French philosopher, and he said, the concept is a brick. It can be used to build a courthouse of reason, or it can be thrown through the window. And throughout this talk, we will identify all those bricks that make up OP exploits, Windows mitigations, Windows exploit mitigation, and we will see how we can use those to break Windows. So what's on the agenda? We'll start talking about OOP 101. I will dumb down the things as much as possible, make it simple so everyone can understand. Then we'll talk about Windows exploit mitigations, and we'll see how we can abuse them. Next, about OOP mitigations, and we'll see how we can bypass them. And lastly, there will be a demo where you will clap hands, and if you will all, we will all behave yourself, there will be a little surprise too. So let's start. We can't start talking about OOP exploit without mentioning smashing the stack for fun and profit. And is there anyone in the audience that ever heard the term for fun and profit? Please raise your hand.
Yeah.
It's quite common. I hope you all know where the source of this term came from. And it's an article by Aleph Wan that he wrote in 96 about the mechanics of stack overflow. And we can't talk about Stack Overflow without explaining how stack semantics work. So if you call a function in a 32-bit processor, you first need to push the parameters on the stack, and the stack on my slides will grow upwards. And then when the call opcode is issued, the return address is pushed in the stack, and the instruction pointer jumps to the function that you call. Now that function will allocate space for itself on the stack, do its stuff, and eventually it will deallocate the space, and the retro code will pop the return address from the stack. So how Stack Overflow works? Well, let's take hypothetical example, completely hypothetical. Let's say you have a program that gets an input and looks for details about the user. So it first allocates its space for the stack, then it uses getS to receive a buffer from the user. Now a normal user will just fill up a few bytes of the buffer, but the hacker will start overwriting the buffer until eventually, the hacker overwrites the return address. So now, if you're a lead hacker, you won't just write random bytes, you will write your shellcode instead. And on the place that you write the return address, let's say hypothetical again, you know the address of the stack, you can just write the address of the stack where your shellcode starts. So now when the return code will be issued, the instruction pointer will jump to the shellcode on your stack, and now you can run a shell. Now, this is not a hypothetical at all. That was the exact source code and the exact buffer overflow, the exact shellcode that was used on the Morris wall. And that was 1988, almost a decade before Aleph Wan published his article on Stack Overflow. So the security industry actually knew about Stack Overflow and the potential hazardous disaster that it can make, but still didn't do anything. And it was so bad that it prompted the formation of the self-coordination center. So again, you would think that after Aleph Wan published his article, the security industry will wake up and start protecting everyone, but no, in 2003, all he had to do to exploit the buffer overflow was to write this simple HTML page. That's a CVE by Matt Miller, and what happened behind the scene is that Internet Explorer just replaced every slash character with an underline slash underline, which caused it to miscalculate the amount of bytes that it needed to write. And then it caused you to write like the first buffer to the stack, and you had the ability to override the return address, and then you could write the shellcode. But now this is not an OS where you can guess the address of the stack. This is Windows, it's a modern OS. Well, yeah, then Matt Miller used a different trick. He knew that the system DLLs were always loaded to the same address. So he looked at those DLLs and found an opcode which is jump ESP, which was always on the same address. So instead of writing the address of the stack, he wrote the address of that command. So now when the return opcode is issued, the instruction pointer jumps to the jump ESP, and after it executes jump ESP, now the instruction pointer points to the stack and you can pop calc if you want. Now you might ask yourself, well, how is it even possible to run code from the stack? Shouldn't it be just read-write memory? Well, that was possible a long, long time ago, until DEP came in on Windows XP Service Pack 2. And therefore, data execution prevention actually enforces the read-write, or more precisely, the non-execute code in memory. Because Windows, throughout time, always marked that memory as only read-write, but the CPU ignored that. And Windows had to add another bit, which is called the annex bit, which forces the CPU to actually not execute code in that area. And that was actually the cornerstone for ROP. It actually made ROP what it is today. And the reason why is now that because now we need a bridge between actually exploiting a software and writing our shellcode to that memory and running it. So ROP fills the bridge between those two things. Now another thing you might ask yourself, what do you mean that all DLLs are loaded to the same address? Well, again, that was the reality back then, until ASLR, or address space level resynchronization, came. And with ASLR, every time you boot your machine, Windows randomized the base address of each DLL. So now you can't guess the address, you need to find it. Now, it is effective mostly on remote exploits, because if you can run code on the same machine, let's say you're trying to exploit a privilege escalation bug, well, you can just run a benign program that loads those DLLs, and you know the address of those DLLs. So I want to take a little step back to help people that want to write exploits today to see some steps that we overlooked when we saw the Stack Overflow. Because Stack Overflow looks very simple. You just write bytes and you control the machine. So let's see what those are if you want to write exploits today. First, you need to have vulnerable software. You need to have access to that software so you can run your code again and again and again until you perfect your exploit to make it running well. Next, we had a way to gather information. So on the Morrisworm case, we knew the address of the stack. On the Matt Miller CVE, we knew the system and function addresses. Today, you will need an arbitrary read vulnerability that will allow you to leak those addresses when you run your exploit. Next, you need a way to manipulate memory. So Stack Overflow, obviously, you write the stack, so you have a way to write into the memory. You have other ways to write into memory, like heap overflow or use after free, which sometimes allows you to do that. And if you want to write exploit today, this kind of vulnerability is called arbitrary write. So if you have arbitrary read and arbitrary write, you probably have a way to exploit the software. And the last step, which I think is the most important to understand, is that you don't actually write code to the target process you're trying to exploit. When you hijack the code execution, it's actually a byproduct of both writing memory into that process and the normal execution. So if you think about the red opcode that simply jumps into the shellcode from the Morrisworm is the normal flow of execution of the program, and we abuse that normal flow of execution to run our shellcode. So now we're ready to play. So let's talk about return-oriented programming, or ROP. And the term was coined by Chovav Shacham on his article, The Geometry of Innocent Flesh on the Bone, which I think is one of the most amazing titles someone can give. And the main idea behind it is to reuse existing code in memory by leveraging the stack semantics. So let's understand how it works. In normal flow of execution, when your program runs, the instruction pointer and the instructions control the flow of execution. So every time an instruction is issued, the instruction pointer automatically advances to the next instruction. So now you have the instructions running one after the other. On ROP, the register that controls the execution is the stack pointer or the stack. So you are looking for a set of instructions that end with a ref. So now the instructions are running, and when the ref opcode is issued, the next set of instructions will be fetched from the stack, because that's the return address that over there. So now you're running another set of instructions that are followed by ref, which fetches the next set of instructions. So now the stack pointer is controlling the execution of the stack. And luckily for us, the stack is read-write memory, which we can control if we have the proper vulnerability. Okay, so one of the most important terms on ROP is gadgets. And a gadget is a sequence of instructions that usually ends with a ref that allows you to perform logical operations. Let's say you can copy a value into memory, you can change the memory permission of memory area into executable, or load values in specific registers, and many more. Let's see an example. If you want to write Yes, an assembly code that write value into memory. You will probably read, write this this code. You will load the value into EAX, load the destination into ECX, and then use the move opcode to move the data from EAX into the destination of ECX. So we are working with a stack, so we can replace the first two moves with pops. Let's see how it will work in a row. So you have the stack on the middle, and the memory and code on the right, and the registers on the left. So we will start with the first set of instructions, which is pop EAX. Now you pop that beef into EAX, and the red opcode will take us to the next set of instructions, which is pop ECX red. So now we pop the address we want to write to, the 61230, and now the red opcode will take you to the next set of instructions, which is the move EAX into ECX. So now we are writing the dead beef into the address we wanted. Okay, so most of the talks on ROP only mentioned 32 bits, but we are in 2019, it's about time we start talking about 64-bit ROPs. So the main difference between 32 and 64-bit ROPs is that when you pass the parameters for a function, you need to load the first four parameters on R6, RDX, R8, and R9. Next, you need to allocate 32 bits on the stack, you don't need to fill it with anything. Lastly, all the other parameters are passed similarly to 32 bits. How does it look like? Well, if you want to call a 64-bit function to receive five parameters, again, it's a pseudocode, you first push the first parameter to the stack, now you load the first parameter into RCX, the second into RDX, the third into R8, and the fourth into R9. Next, you need to allocate the 32 bytes, and the call instruction works similar to 32-bit and pushes the return address on the stack. So, very similar to 32-bit. And the example which we will see today will be 64-bit. So what do we do with a ROP? Usually you would want to call either virtual protect or virtual alloc. Virtual protect allows you to change the protection of a memory address into executable. So if you have the shellcode already in memory, you just need to change it into executable and jump to that address. Or you can also allocate using virtual alloc and executable memory and copy your shellcode into that address and running. Now, because those two functions are the main targets of ROP, the endpoint protection will actually monitor those functions, and we will see later how they do it. So, a lot of the time when you write ROP, most of the time will be wasted looking for gadgets. And I want to suggest you just look at anti-DLL, and there are a few reasons to do it. First, anti-DLL is loaded into every process on the system, so you don't need to hope that the DLL you exploited before will be on the process, because anti-DLL is always there. So if you find the gadgets on anti-DLL, you might be able to use those gadgets on every other exploit you will use. And another thing that contributes to that is because anti-DLL is so close to the kernel, then a lot of the code in anti-DLL is handwritten assembly. And if you ever wrote assembly, you know that you write it once and you don't touch it. It just works. So now, if you find a gadget that it's handwritten assembly, most of the chances that it works from the very early version of Windows, sometimes even Windows Vista. And the gadget I will show you works from at least Windows 7. And that's a lot of power if you can write your ROP once and use it on every other exploit you will ever need. So let's see some gadgets on the TBLL. So the first is the function RTL copy LUID. And that function even doesn't look if you are copying LUID. It just copies 64 bytes from the destination you give from the source into the destination. And how it looks like in assembly, it simply loads the value from the source, which is in RDX, it's the second parameter, into RX, and copy that value into RCX, which is the destination that you gave. But because we are writing the stack, we don't need to write a return address to the beginning of that function. We can skip 3 bytes directly into the second opcode, and now we have the gadget that can move RX into the destination RCX. Now there is a similar gadget that exists throughout all versions of Windows, the move RCX into the address in RX. It's in the function RTL set XML feature mask, and you can use it everywhere, but now you need a way to load values into RX and RCX. So how you do it? Well, modern compilers are aware of ROP and will not emit pop RX ret or pop RCX ret in their code. But what they do emit is like add RSP58X bytes, which is just deallocating the stack for 58X bytes. But apparently, the byte 58 is pop RX. So if you skip 3 bytes into the middle of the opcode, you get pop RX ret, and that opcode exists a lot of time in anti-DLL. And very similarly, if you're looking for pop RCX, you have the multiply XMM0 with XMM3, which allows you to skip 2 bytes, and now you have pop RCX RAM. So now we have a way to copy any value we want in memory. Next, I want to show you another great gadget, which is on anti-DLL check stack, again, handwritten assembly, and I'll soon explain to you why, because it first loads the top of the stack into R10, then the next value into R11, then it simply deallocates the stack, and returns. And it's simply like writing pop R10, pop R11 read. And how do I know that this is handwritten assembly? Because only if you read the Intel manual back then when Windows wrote the code, you know that this was more efficient way to write it. So I didn't want to show you pop R10, but if you skip just 1 byte, you have pop EDX. So now you can load both RCX and EDX, so you have 2 parameters you can pass to function. So that's the thing you can start working with. Another very important gadget, well, obviously not pop R12, it's the pop RSP. And this gadget is called the stack pointer, the stack pivot. Because sometimes when you have exploits, you can only write a limited amount of bytes into the stack when you hijack the stack. And this gadget allows you to write the whole rock into the heap or a place where you can write a lot of code and simply pivot the stack into that address. So now you just need to write the return address into the stack pivot and you can have a rock as long as you want. Now, one of the most powerful gadgets on anti-DLL is actually a function. It's called anti-continue, which gets 2 parameters. And I can tell you that you can completely ignore the second parameter, it doesn't do anything. And context is contains the processor-specific register data, which means you can actually replace all the values in all the registers of the currently running thread. So now you can control not only R6, RDX, R8, R10, R9, you can also control the stack pointer and the instruction pointer. So that's a very powerful gadget that you can use. Now the last gadget I want to show is RTL Move Memory, where you want to copy a large amount of data between memory. Now, I like to make analogies because it better explains things, and I want to compare gadgets to the R technique called the ready-made. Okay, so the ready-made technique was invented by a French artist called Marcel Duchamp, and if you think the French people only contributed to the world by inventing, I don't know, like croissant, baguette, democracy, and mimicats, then they did some other stuff as well. So, this is a... This heart piece called Fountain, which is just urinal turned on its side and signed with his pseudonym, Armut, which Marcel Duchamp did. And what he writes about it explains exactly, I think, what gadgets are all about. Whether Mr. Matt with his own hands made this the fountain or not has no importance. He chose it. He took an ordinary article of life and placed it so that its useful significance disappeared under the new title and point of view, created a new thought for that object. And if you think about it, that's exactly what we are doing with gadgets. And if you follow this train of thought, well, like the fountain is an art piece, our little gadgets are little pieces of virtual art. Sorry? So if you follow this train of thought, and our gadgets are little pieces of art, it actually makes anti-DLL the public bathroom of Windows. Okay, so with that thought in mind, let's move on to Windows exploit mitigations. We'll start with stack canaries, and stack canaries protect you against buffer overflow. It works by first generating a random base canary value whenever a process is started, and then it writes a cookie into the stack using a calculation of that base value. Now, when the return opcode is issued before the return opcode is actually executed, it performs the reverse calculation and checks that the value we got is the base canary value. So now we can actually see if someone actually overridden the stack. And let's see pseudocode, how it works. So it first loads the base canary value into ECX, then it stores the value with the stack pointer. So now it's not only as an attacker, you don't only need to guess the base canary value, you should also guess the current stack pointer, which is very hard, and then you push the value into the stack. Now before the return opcode, let's say an attacker actually managed to override the stack, the opcode will pop the canary stack from the canary value from the stack, will XOR it again, and will call a function that verifies if the value was changed, and because it did, it will actually crash the process. Next mitigation I want to talk about is the Windows 8 drop mitigation, which is a very big name, but it actually just detects stack pivot. So whenever you are calling memory functions on Windows, starting from Windows 8, it will actually check that the stack pointer points to a valid location on the stack. So if you used a stack pivot on your ROP, well, Windows will detect it and will crash the software. And now, it's very easy to guess how you can bypass it. You simply need to make sure that the stack pointer points to a valid location on the stack when you are calling Windows 32 API. So how can you fetch the stack pointer value? Well, you can abuse stack canaries. So for the first technique I'll show you, I call it a little bear told me, and we will see how we can abuse using a ROP stack canary to fetch the value of RSP. And the main steps we will take is we'll first prepare the registers, then we'll call a benign function that uses stack canary. We will fetch that cookie from the stack. You can treat it like a use or read after free vulnerability. And then we'll XOR that value with a base canary value. And if you remember before, I told you that you need to have a memory read vulnerability. And if you have that memory read vulnerability, you can actually fetch that base value from the DLL you are calling. So we will assume that we have that value on the ROP already. So you have the code on the left, on the top right you have the registers, and on the bottom right you have the stack. So the stack is also split between the address on the left and the values on the right. So we will start with the pop gadget, which will pop the values that we want. We want to prepare the registers. The important registers we are preparing now are R6 and R9. R6 is a parameter for the function we are calling, and R9 we will see later what it is used for. And now the red will take us to the next function, which is RTL is valid process trust label SID. What it does, I don't even care. The only thing I care about is that it uses stack canaries and it doesn't mess up with the registers or the stack itself. So first this function allocates place on the stack. Next it fetches the base canary value in the REX, you can see it over there. Now it will XOR the value with the stack pointer. So this is the stack cookie we're using. And later it saves that value into the stack. So you can see the same value on REX, you can find it now on the stack. Now because we passed the parameter to the function, we passed a bad parameter and the function will start to go into the exit sequence. So now right before calling the ret opcode, it fetches the value, the stack cookie from the stack into RCX. Now it will XOR it with the stack pointer. So now we have the base canary value and it called the functions that check the cookie. And because we are innocent, we didn't do anything wrong here, well, just calling a function, well, that function will pass correctly. And now, before I execute this, I need to remind you, the canary cookie is still on the stack. So we are deallocating the stack, but actually the stack memory is like the memory in any other place on the computer. So if no one written or overwritten that value is still there. So now we will jump to a special gadget that will allow us to fetch that value. And that gadget is in RTLP execute handler for exception. Again, all the gadgets you're seeing here are from NVDLL. This is handwritten assembly, and you can guess it's used for exception handling, but this gadget actually allocates space on the stack, and now it calls. You can see that now we have the cookie on the stack, on our stack value, and now it will call a pointer that is controlled by R9. So if you remember the first gadget we used, we popped R9 to control the value. So can you guess where we are going with this now, what gadget we will use? Well, we're going to the same pop gadget that we used before. So now we are popping values from the stack, and the important thing is that now R9 will receive the canary cookie. So now we have the cookie on R9, all we need to do is to fetch the base canary value and XOR it. So now the ret opcode, you can see it will take us to the next gadget, the pop-R8, you know that one. This will fetch the base canary value into R8X, and the ret opcode will take us to the last gadget, which is XOR R9 with REX, and this is part of RTL decode system pointer, another function on NVDLL, and now we have the stack pointer, and we can pivot from here and continue our ROP. Okay, so now for the next mitigation, we will talk about the control flow guard or CFG, and the idea behind it is to mitigate control flow hijacking of indirect calls. What are indirect calls? Let's say you're writing CPP code and the compiler needs to fetch the address of the function from the virtual table. So it will write with a meet code, which looks like this. It fetches the address of the parent of the function into RAX, then loads the parameter RCX, RDX, and R8 for like three parameters for this function, and we'll call RAX. So CFG actually replaces RAX. Wait, I'll take a step back. If you are an attacker, you can actually hijack the value that will be saved into RAX, and then you can call any function you want or any place in memory you want. So control flow guard actually replaces the control RAX with a call to guard dispatch. I call it FPTR. Sometimes it's just a check and there is another call RAX later. It depends on implementation. But actually this function will check that RAX is valid. Function and no one overwritten it. How it does it? It uses a huge bit field where every bit marks if a function starts at a specific address in memory. So it's a coarse grain. It doesn't know if those are the functions you actually wanted to call, but if there is a function starting there, and it doesn't matter what DLL it is, it will say that it's valid. What it gives us is that you won't be able to call in the middle of function and then mess with the stack itself. So now comes the questions. How can we abuse CFG? Well, we already did. Do you remember I told you that CFG replaces the call with a call guard dispatch I call FPTR? Well, actually that function translates into NTDLL functions called LDRP validate user call target. And that function checks the bit field, you can see it, and then down below you can see that if it finds that there is no function over there, it jumps into LDRP handle invalid user call target. And if this name sounds familiar, because that's the pop gadget we just used. So thank you, Microsoft, for introducing one of the best gadgets for ops out there and making it available in every app, every goddamn process on the system. Now I need to ask sorry for all the people exploiting this, because if Microsoft is watching this, they probably take it away from us. But wait, there is more. If you will look at them at the MSDN, we'll see there is a function called set process valid call targets. And this function actually allows you to tell CFG what addresses are valid. So let's say if you can potentially exploit an indirect call twice, you can first call set process valid call target, set the target you want as a valid target, then call it again. So what do you think? Do you think Microsoft actually protect a valid function that is published on MSDN? Well, apparently they do. So nice one, Microsoft, but not that nice, because if you look at set process valid call targets, it's actually a wrapper around an NTDLL function called anti-set information virtual memory. And you know what? Anti-set information virtual memory is actually valid call indirect target. So you can call this function, tell Windows that it's a valid target, and then abuse the same exploit again to run whatever function you want or whatever others you want. It's actually like telling Windows, those are not the exploits you're looking for, and you know. The force is powerful and the weak-minded. Okay, so let's talk about ROP mitigations. And we will talk first about ROP guard, which is the mitigation that is implemented by most endpoint security today, or at least a variation of it. And it uses strategic hooks on a memory function, like I told you before, on the virtual protect, virtual alloc, all the matching NTDLL functions, and all functions that allow you to create processes. And what it does, it fetches the return address from the stack and look at the opcode preceding it to see if there is a call to that function. And if there is no call opcode before the return address, then how did this return address go to the stack? Now, it doesn't only check that there is a call, it also checks that the call opcode actually calls the function that we are hooking. So that's the ROP guard in general. Does have some more tricks to do, but most of them simply checks that there is a call opcode. Now, K-Bouncer is like a ROP guard on steroids, if you would like. It actually utilizes a feature on CPU called last branch records, which saves the last indirect jumps or calls you had. So you have the source and the target address, and you can actually perform similar checks to ROP guard on those addresses too. So if you can think about it, ROP guard actually checks the return address, which is the future of execution. K-Bouncer also checks the past of the execution that already happened. Now, I know that there are very few vendors that implemented kVarchar, but most of them only implemented RobGuard. Now, another mitigation is RobPacker, which I haven't seen implemented anywhere. And the idea behind it is to use the same mechanism as DEP, the data execution prevention, to mark all the memory as non-executable except for the current executing page and the next one. So now, whenever the execution jumps outside of that area, there will be an exception thrown, and RobPacker will catch this exception and will perform similar checks to kVarchar. But because it happens a lot, the heuristics that it uses are a lot weaker than kVarchar. Now, the last mitigation I want to mention is ShadowStack, which is a collaboration between Microsoft and Intel. It was first proposed in 2016, but it was never implemented. They suggest to use two different stacks. One, the regular stack that you have and we all know about, and another, a magic kernel stack that only saves the return address. So whenever there is a call of code, the return address is pushed both to the user mode stack and the kernel stack, and when there is a ret, it will pop both addresses. And if the addresses are incorrect, well, then you know that someone overwritten the stack. But as I said before, it was proposed in 2016. There is no implementation of it anywhere that I know of. And let's see how you can bypass it. So before I tell you my effort, I want to suggest you a paper to read or a Black Hat talk to watch, which is called The Beast is in Your Memory by Daniel Lehman and Ahmed Reza Zadegi. And they explain how you can bypass RobPacker kVarchar by abusing their heuristic. And if you think about it, when they say they're abusing their heuristic, they're actually have an intention of being caught. And I don't like being caught. This is why I invented a new technique called rite of passage, which allows you to bypass the rob mitigations without even being caught or without going through any of the endpoint security's hooks. So we collected a lot of bricks so far, and there is still one more brick we need to collect to understand how we can completely break Windows. And this one is the syscall. So syscall is the way you transition from user mode to kernel mode. And whenever you call virtual protect or virtual alloc or any other Win32 function, it usually translates into a system call function inside NTDLL. Again, handwritten assembly. So all of those functions will look very similar to anti-allocate virtual memory. It first moves the first parameter from RCX and saves it into R10. Next, it loads the system call parameter into EAX, and on the case of anti-allocate virtual memory, I think it's Windows 10, the value will be 18 hex. Let's say for anti-protect virtual memory, that will be 50 hex. So every function has a different number. Next, it issues the syscall command, and the syscall is actually the opcode that transitions into kernel mode, but it always goes to the same function in kernel. So how does this function know which function you want to run? Well, it looks at EAX. So now it knows that because EAX is loaded with 18 hex, you want to run anti-allocate the virtual memory. Now when the function finishes on the kernel, it will return to user mode and the function will continue. So as I said before, all the endpoint protection usually hook those functions. So now you have a hook on the function, and if your ROP goes through that function, it will go through the endpoint hook. Some vendors even go as far as overwrite the whole function, so you will not even know that it's there, don't know why they should do it. But you know what? They don't hook all functions. Let's say anti-yield execution, which is actually a function that does nothing. It's like the insecure function of a program, if you want. It just tells Windows, well, I don't know if I have anything important to do right now. Maybe you decide if I need to continue execution or someone else do the execution. It's a function that has no interest to anyone, maybe for us. But another thing that you can see, how do I know that this is handwritten assembly or a macro that just copies the same values everywhere? It's because anti-yield execution doesn't get any parameter. So why do you need to pass RCX and R10 if RCX holds no valuable data? Well, that's handwritten assembly. But we can actually abuse anti-yield execution or any other function on NTDLL which is not hooked for our calls. And how do we do it? Well, we will start with a pop RAX ret gadget that loads the system call into RAX. Next, we'll use another gadget that you've seen before that allows us to load R10. So now we can also prepare the first parameter. And next, we will not call empty execution, we will jump 18 bytes directly into the system call. And now if you look at it, we actually have a way to issue any system call we want using a ROP, and because we don't pass through any of the endpoint protection hooks, no one even know that our ROP was there, and no one catch us. So I wrote a little tool, which I will publish on my Git later. It's called ROP injector, which first allocates a read-write memory into the target process. It writes the shellcode into that process. Then it will create a new thread on that process and injects the ROP into that process using a get process context and set thread context. And lastly, the ROP will modify that area into read-write-execute using either a regular call to virtual protect or a rite of passage call to anti-protect virtual memory. And lastly, it will run the shellcode. So let's see how it works. So I want to change things a bit. So I will not pop a calculator with my demo. I will actually inject a ROP into calc with my demo. So you need to pass the process ID to the ROP injector. So now we will pass the process ID of the calculator. And we're injecting a regular ROP. And you can see that our shellcode injected created a mutex called POM. So obviously it worked. Now I will tell you a little secret. Endpoint protection don't protect all processes on your system. They usually protect only the vulnerable, like Firefox. So now when you try to inject, you can see that the endpoint protection caught the ROP. So now we'll try to run Firefox again, and we will use the rite of passage ROP instead of the regular ROP. And the endpoint protection didn't even see it coming, or see it that it even happened. Okay. So. Okay. So thank you. You all behaved very.